Well, welcome again, happy Sabbath.
Happy Sabbath.
I am not going to speak even half the time we have a Sabbath school. So don't worry, I'm not going to sit here for another hours at a time because we have so much on our program today, and I think that God's going to bless us here tremendously. But I would encourage every one of you to grab a Bible, or at least look to the neighbor's Bible, as we're going to go through short reading. Or you just listen if you want. Let us open first to Mark 9. Mark 9. The book of Mark is this interesting story. We often read about this particular story. And sometimes you wonder why. But let's start reading it and see what is the story about. Mark 9, verses 15 through 25. Mark 9, verses 15 through 25. Oh, wait, 14. When he came to the disciples, he saw a great multitude around them and scribes disputing with them. Immediately, when they saw him, all the people were greatly amazed, and running to him, greeted him. And he asked the scribes, "What are you discussing with them?" Then one of the crowd answered and said, "Teacher, I brought you my son, who is a mute spirit. And wherever it seizes him, it throws him down. He foams at the mouth, gnashes his teeth, and becomes rigid. So I spoke to your disciples, and they should cast it out, but they could not." He answered him and said, "O faithless generation, how long shall I be with you? How long shall I bear with you? Bring him to me." Then they both brought him to him, and he saw him. Immediately the spirit convulsed him, and he fell on the ground and wallowed, foaming at the mouth. So he asked his father, "How long has this been happening to him?" And he said, "From childhood. And often he has thrown him both in the fire and the water and destroy him. But if you can do anything, you have compassion on us and help us." Jesus said to him, If you can believe, all things are possible to him who believes." Immediately the father of the child cried out and said with tears, "Lord, I believe. Help my unbelief." When Jesus saw that the people came running together, he rebuked the unclean spirit, saying to it, "Deaf and mute and dumb spirit, I command you, come out of him and enter him no more." Then the spirit cried out, convulsed him greatly, and came out of him, and he became one as one dead, so that many said, "He is dead." But Jesus took him by the hand and lifted him up, and he arose. And when he had come out into this house, his disciples asked him privately, "Why could we not cast it out?" And Jesus and he said to them, "This kind can come out by nothing but prayer and fasting." I read a little bit more than I was supposed to. But here's an interesting story about a doubt. Look at the father for a moment. The father came to Jesus. His heart was torn, as we read in the story, between two desires, two feelings, maybe said this way. He wanted to what, most of all?
Healing
for his son. But he felt that he is nothing. And he could not receive the blessing because of lack of faith. Right? He said, "Help my belief." Can you come to Jesus with doubts?
Yes.
"God, please heal me, but I don't know how. I don't know if you are powerful enough. I don't know, but you are the one who always carried me through. I don't see you today. I don't see your power. I don't feel your presence. Should I pray or should I not? Should I come to you? Everything is falling on my head. Falling down my head, all the problems and troubles. Still, can I come to you? Should I come to you?" should we?
Yes.
Look at this interesting story. Do you think if the father would not ask Jesus for healing, would the boy be healed? Probably not. What I'm saying that, because there is part of our, with this part we must do. There is not much, because we cannot do much at all. We cannot clean ourselves, cleanse ourselves in God from sin. We cannot walk in God's way. We cannot be good.
We can express our need.
That's right. Look at two stories about this. There's a story in Mark, a couple of verses back, Mark 6, and verse... This is a story about Jesus walking on the water. Oh, what a wonderful story it is. If the Dead Sea was more saltier, you could probably walk. You cannot drown in the Dead Sea, because there's no way of diving in the Dead Sea, because such a salt, there's no way. But maybe I'm thinking they're saying wrong, but that's what I heard. But look at the story about the Jesus sent disciples on a boat, and there was a storm, that's right. The storm was great, the disciples were kind of afraid, and what's going on? We're going to drown. The boat is going to capsize, and we're going to be all gone, and they saw Jesus walking on the water. Let's start with from Mark 6, verse 48. Then he saw them straining and rowing, for the wind was against them. Now about the fourth watch of the night, he came to them walking on the sea and would have passed it by. Have you ever thought about this interesting statement? He was walking on the sea as would he pass them by. But he did not because they cried out. Another story like this. God wants your attention by calling him. God wants you to realize that you need him. He is not automatically going to come to you. He's asking you, call upon me. There's another story in Revelation 3:20, where it says that he stands on the door at the door and he knocks. And what is our action?
We should open.
We should open. And whoever here. Okay, so 3:20 says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and die with him. Again, we need to call upon God. Action on our thing. We cannot, as sometimes I said, when I read Revelation 3:20, it's about, I need to come to the door. Sometimes you cannot get up on the couch of sin, and you just have to say, open the door, or break the door in. Because God can do that. But he requires us to ask. He inspires us, call for me. Because you know what? We are under the principle of this world. And who is the prince of this world?
Sin.
And he does not want Jesus to help. But if the child of a prince called for the king of universe, he doesn't want the prince. King can overrule. That's right?
Amen.
So, here the action. Remember the story from John 6? It's the story from John. Let's go to John again. John and verse chapter 6, the story about how many disciples there were. We always hear about 12, that's right? Were there any more?
Mm-hmm.
Like we said, it was 70 of them or so, that's right?
Mm-hmm.
And what's happened to the 70? What's ended up with 70 dwindled to 12? Huh? Well, no, first was 12 disciples and they left. So here's the story in John 6. We had the story when Jesus was speaking so hard, they said, we cannot listen to this anymore. And they stopped following him. And it says here in verse 5, and he said, therefore I have said to you that no one can come to me unless I have been granted to him by my Father.
What chapter?
John 6.
No.
John 6, verses 65.
Oh, 65.
I'm sorry. And let's go move to verse 67. Then Jesus said to the 12, "Do you also want to go away?" But Simon Peter answered him, "Lord, to whom shall we go? Interesting. Sometimes we think that we need to follow Jesus because he has such a great blessings. But honestly speaking, we are there sometimes because, very great quotation for you. Now Philip Yancey, it says, kind of paraphrasing, "You don't want to leave too, do you? You don't want to leave too, do you?" The answer is not a striking proclamation of heroic faith. Frankly, the response is a bit weak. The disciple replied, "Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of life." It is a statement of faith, but also reflects a spectrum of unknowns. "That for me is the bottom line," answer why I stick around. To my shame, I admit that one of the strongest reasons I stayed in the fold is the lack of good alternatives, many of which I have tried. "Lord, to whom shall I go?" The only thing more difficult than having a relationship with an invisible God is having no such a relationship. So basically saying, we are here because there is no other way. I mean, there is no other option. I mean, where would you move? If you are feeling forsaken, if you pray for something that does not happen, if everything happens wrong, where would you go? Are you going to go to agnostic world, atheistic world? Or are you going to stay faithful to God? Peter said, "Where should we go? Where should we go?" And I find myself in a situation like this when I was sick. I prayed, no answer. And I'm asking my question, there is no God, where should I go? Why should I go anywhere from here? I will still continue praying. Because there is no, in atheistic world, I was born atheist, and I know there is nothing there. But God is there, and for me, it's enough if I can have someone I can even talk to and get an answer. Because I know He's faithful. We need to begin when we are. We don't need to be made to a form to come to God, to accept. So can we reconcile doubt and faith? Can we be always faithful? Is the doubt never come into our minds? No. We are both. Doubt and faith, constantly. I am on the mountaintop today. Tomorrow I am going to be down the valley again. We have to try the God of the mountaintops. But yet, as Psalm 23 says, sometimes He puts us in the valley, yes? So, if you think about God, some students wrote this. They're questioning God and asking about stuff like this. And the question was like this: how much does God really want from us anyway? Does the absence of our doubt somehow makes miracles happen more often? Does God ask us to live mindlessly out in faith, experiencing miracles, as if by our action we move God to do something He would not otherwise do? How much faith do I really need? How do you quantify faith? How do you know when you have enough faith? You know what? Sometimes we have to just put all the cards on the table, as somebody says, and say, "God, this is my doubt. Take me as we are. Take my faith that is non-existent. Take the lack of faith. Take it, and have it. Because you promised take me as I am and give me everything as you are. And this is so beautiful. I cannot do anything. Can we do anything? You know, like my parents who are atheists. The question is, are they ever under influence of the Holy Spirit?
Yes.
My dad says, or my mom, you know, we are good people. Why can't God save us in heaven forever? Do you think the goodness comes from within them? They can? Oh, of course not. God inspires them despite who they are. Even denying Him, not believing Him whatsoever. It does not matter. The goodness in every human being comes from God because there is no goodness in Satan.
Amen.
Is there any good thing in Satan anymore?
No.
Used to be.
Yes.
So give Him your lungs of anything. Give Him anything you don't have. Okay? You don't have faith? Give it to Him. You have a trust? Give it to Him. On the other hand, look at the disciples when Jesus gave them the power to heal demons and heal sick and, you know, cast away demons. Do you think they had to have enough faith to do that? No, it was given to them. Like, sorry, maybe this is the wrong word to say it here, but like magic. They were just coming and said, "This is so cool. Be healed in the name of Jesus." Boom, happened. Get away the demon from this person. Boom, happened. It's like, wow. They didn't have to have, they were so young in their faith. The power was given to them. And they were just overwhelmed by this sometimes, like, wow, this is so good. But yet, the example of this healing says, that's not enough. Yes, you have my power, but you have to understand where the power comes from. By connection with the Father. He said, by fasting and prayer, connect with the Father. This is not of yours, but you are thinking that you have some kind of magical powers. It comes from the Father in heaven. Keep connection, and you're going to have that power continuously. So you can see those gathered, you know, people gathering around that boy, one by one, the disciple coming and said, "Go, be gone, that demon." Nothing happens. Peter comes, "Go, demon." Nothing happens. James comes, "Go, demon." Nothing happens. I'm starting to think maybe we should go around and ask everybody if there's any unconfessed sins around us. No, that's not the point. Because God uses us in spite of us. And I can be example, and I'm standing here preaching to you. And Paul was the same way. He said, "I am trembling about my salvation. If I preach to others, I'm not myself yours." Because, you know, I can say good things here and be used by, like we're talking in Sabbath school today, the person who was used by God rode the donkey and the angel showed up. You remember the story?
Yeah. Amen.
Was he used by God?
Mm-hmm.
Was he God? Was he Christian?
Yeah.
Not really. I mean, No, he was Christian, but no, he was not he was not God. So the sense God used him despite of him. So, you know, here could be somebody preaching who is not at all. So there is another quotation I'll read in closing regarding how the Father would feel. It's like, look, this is the Father of the boy saying, imagine, like imagination. "With as much as I know and as much as I have experience and as much evidence as I have, I know that God is real and He is good and He is powerful and He is here. I believe God knows. I believe God acts. But there is so much I think I should believe that is beyond my reach and beyond my trust. My faith gets me just so far. I'm afraid if I go too far out on the land, it will just break home. I feel that my desire to believe things that would be wonderful are just wishful thinking on my part. And I don't want to look like a fool. I don't want to be taken in. If I believe and worship God, I want to know this God is real. So God, in all honesty, this is me. I do believe, but I think there is more I should believe, but I have not been able to believe. Help me. I want to believe. It's enough for now. How many times are you finding yourself this way? God, please, I don't know what to do. I believe, but I do not know if I can go that far. I want to believe. I want to desire more. I want to be better. I want to be changed. But yet, I can't. Take my cans. Take my burdens away. Take my weaknesses away. That's all I can offer you. That feel, like we, today again we read in Zechariah, that's right? When the filthy garment was taken away and the new white cloth garment was put on. We cannot do it. We cannot even take it away. We can only say, here I am. Clean me, cleanse me, change me. Is there any burdens in your heart? Is there any lack of faith in you? I have a homework for you. Grab a piece of paper. Write in your own language, for those who don't write English very well. That's a private note. Write a couple of things that you are you angry with God sometimes? Write it down. God, I'm angry with you because you neglected me. Because I am sick and I'm not getting better. Because I'm angry and I'm not getting any better. Getting release. Because you don't have faith, because you have some burden, because you are angry. Is there anything in your heart that you want to write to God and say, you do not work in my life as I want to. It could be one word, it could be a sentence, it could be several things. Let's say, God, I'm really upset with you today because you have not. That. Or I'm overpowered by this experience. Or somebody drives me crazy. I don't see you today, or I have not seen you in my life. Or I have this sin that always bites me. I have this weakness in my heart. It's your private note, nobody's going to read it. Write to God your anger if you want to. Write to God your disappointment. Whatever it is. Thank you. there is a power from God that you can celebrate communion service today. You remember what He has done for you, don't you? Isabella is going to reach you something. It is so close. I don't actually tell you what this is all about.
Before I read this, I just want to say for it to really. I just felt like I wanted to tell a story that's about what I've been through, so you can know that God really does work miracles. It's going to be a very long story, very, very shortly done. There's so much more to it, but I just felt like God wanted me to tell you. And so as you know, and it seems like a lot of you don't, but when I was 10, I was going to school one day and I was struck with severe pain in my back and it felt like I couldn't breathe. I had to stay home that day. It was horrible. And over the next few days, it progressed worse and worse until there was so much pain that I couldn't walk. I couldn't stand. I couldn't walk. And every night, I'm just moaning to myself to sleep. And then the day came when I went to the first children's hospital to see what was wrong, and they couldn't figure it out. And of course, it's a very long story, very short, but. I ended up spending 7 weeks in 3 different hospitals. I had to do physical therapy, which was horrible. I say that PT stands for pain and torture. It was just horrible, and it's the worst thing I've ever experienced. But I had people. Most people didn't believe that my pain was real. They thought it was all in my head. They couldn't figure out what it was for weeks and months. And in the hospitals, it was very, very discouraging. This test after test and treatment after treatment did not work. And morphine, whatever that was, and strongest medicines were just like giving nothing to me. They didn't touch the pain at all. And it was the worst pain. I was screaming pain. It was horrible. Months, and nobody could figure out what the pain was. And I had so many treatments after then. The doctors found this tiny, small tumor in my back, and it's small, but it causes pain from its core, and it causes extreme pain, and they found that on the head of my rib, my spine. And so it had been months of just torture, and this was finally going to make me better. It was kind of hard believing it for me, because everything they tried hadn't worked at all. But this was supposed to work. This was going to work. This was going to heal me. And once I took the tumor out, then there was going to be no pain. And so I had surgery in December. They took the tumor out, and the pain was still there, because it had been in there so long that it had damaged the nerves around it, and was sending the pain signals as if the tumor was still there. So it was the exact same pain, just kind of like the phantom pain, but it was just the same. And so after that, it was so discouraging. We had months of just, doctors had given up on me, everyone had given up on me, and I just was trying to accept that maybe this is how I'm going to be forever, and it was really hard. But through those months, I was just, like you were saying, God, I believe you can heal me, but please help my unbelief. I was very discouraged, and it was just hard to believe. Is there a God? Why does he, it was really hard time for me. It's like, don't you care about me? I still had a tiny bit of faith. It was going out, but it was still there. And, the week before I went to camp meeting, which a church's camp meeting, and I had wanted to go to summer camp really bad, just by myself. It was more of a symbolic goal, like I'm going to be walking by summer camp. I will be walking by then, but as the weeks and months went by, it was just not going to happen. And so I was telling my mom I'm not going to get well. I want to go to summer camp. I have to go. I have to. I have to be walking by summer. I can't live like this anymore. And my mom just said, just give it to God. Give it to God. And that by the next week, I told her I gave it to God. If it's not your will, you want me to walk, but if it's not your will for me to walk, if this is how you want me to live for you, then so be it. And if you don't want me to go to summer camp, then your will be done. And that was the hardest thing I've ever done. And when we went to camp meeting, I had a wonderful time there. It was really fun. They included me in everything, but I was still in a wheelchair and so much fun. And on Thursday night, the youth pastors that were there asked if they could pray for me, and of course I've been prayed for many times, anointed many sudden there was a silence, and I didn't know why, but I felt God touch my back. It was a hand that wasn't a human hand. It was peaceful, it was beautiful, and after the prayer, my pain was gone. My whole shoulders had loosened up, my whole back had loosened up. I didn't know what happened. But basically, I can tell you more afterwards. During lunch, whenever you want to know. But anyway, a few days later, when I told my parents, because I just asked my God if I could keep this to myself, because it was just between you and me. So, because I just couldn't process it myself. I needed time to process it. They were all the attention from the people on me. So until I got home, and then I told my parents, and I told them, the next day, my mom said, after the night after I told them, they said, you know, you have to still go to the physical therapist today, even if your pain is gone. You still have to work on your muscles. And I don't know why I said it, but I said, Mommy, I can't walk for you right now. I don't know why I said that, but I got out of the wheelchair and I was walking. And I never had to have any physical therapy. This was 14 months of not walking into therapy. It had been 14 months by now. And I just want you to know that when you give things to God, give your worries, the things that you hate about yourself, the things that you are struggling with. I've never felt such freedom in giving it to God, no matter what it is. And it's still hard for me to give things to God even after that, but you feel so free and you are happy with life. You know it's in God's hands. Long, but I just felt like I wanted to say that. Now, here's a song that feels like it was written for me. I found it a couple days ago, and I haven't learned the song yet. I love you, I love to sing, but I'm just going to read the words to you. It's beautiful, and it fits me perfectly, and it probably fit you because we all have scars, and the song is called What Scars Are For, and it's going to be to you. These scars aren't pretty, but they're a part of me and will not ever fade away. These marks tell a story of me down in the valley and how you reached in with your grace and healed me. They remind me of your faithfulness and all you brought me through. They teach me that my brokenness is something you can use. You show me where I've been, and I'm not there anymore. That's what scars are for. Erase, rewind, wish I could every time. The hurt, the pain cut so deep. But when I'm weak, you're strong, and your power I carry on. And my scars say that you won't ever leave. I see it on the cross, the nails you took for me. Scars can change the world. Scars can set me free. Remind me of your faithfulness and all you brought me through. You teach me that my brokenness is something you can use. Show me where I've been, and I'm not there anymore. So basically now what we are going to do, we're going to be dimming the lights, and about maybe a few of you at a time will come up, and I want you to fold your piece of paper, a little small square, and you're each going to come up and nail whatever you wrote down to the cross, whatever your worries are, whatever you're struggling with, if you're angry at God, if the things that you pain, the worries, you're going to be nailing that to the cross. You're going to give it. If you feel the calling to give this to God, then you can just nail it on the cross. I did this at camp meeting this year, and it was the most beautiful thing. And I hope you all get anything for you.
that those things can be turned by God on his shoulder and take it away. Now we are coming to another sacred service. We're going to continue right after this. The communion service. For those who are not familiar with this, as we do, we're starting with food washing ceremony. You remember when Jesus said in John 13 to wash their disciples' feet? It says here, so when he had washed their feet, taken his garments, and sat down again, he said to them, do you know what I have done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you say, well, for so I am. I then, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, also ought to wash one another's feet. For I'm giving you an example that you should do as I have done to you. So Jesus said, do it, because this is an example. Do it as I have done. So we're going to now divide two groups, men and women. Women can stay here. Whoever like to participate in this sacred ceremony, thank you. You're welcome to do so. It's open to everyone. If you don't want to do it, you don't have to. So women can stay here. We provide them with water and basins and towels, and men can go maybe to the hallway there and to do food washing ceremony. Or whoever would like to do so is welcome to do so. And after that, we gather here together for wine and bread.
Right before he was going to die for us, he showed his disciples a piece of bread, and he said, this bread is going to remind you how I'm about to get hurt and my body's going to be broken. Have you ever gotten hurt before? You haven't? Well, when you get hurt, it really hurts. Have you ever fallen down? No? Well, if you ever gotten a scrape or anything, you know that it hurts when you get hurt, and Jesus had to go through so much hurt. He had so many boo-boos. Because the people hurt him, and he wanted to remind us all that when you eat this bread, remember, you know how bread kind of looks like the color of your skin? Well, it reminds us of Jesus' body and how it was going to be hurt, and he's going to die for us. So that the bread is supposed to remind us of how Jesus' body was hurt. So we remember how much he loves us. And you know what the grape juice represents? You know what that represents? What is it? So the blood represents the blood of Jesus. You know when you get a scrape, it starts bleeding. That hurts a lot. Well, Jesus, he was bleeding a lot, and because the people were hurting him, and he told his disciples that this cup, you know what grape juice kind of looks like, blood?
Yeah.
Well, that represented the blood of Jesus, because he died for us, and he was being hurt, and he was bleeding, and he just wanted to remind us of how much he loves us, that he would even get hurt for us. That's what it took to have us in heaven. And so, when you take this isn't really, now is this Jesus' actual body and his blood? No, it just reminds us that he loves us so much that he would bleed for us and he would get hurt for us, and that he was going to die for us so we can be in heaven. Do you want to go to heaven? Yes. Heaven's going to be a wonderful place. Now, so when you take, here, do you want me? Now, when you take this piece, do you see how it's supposed to remind you of how much Jesus loves you, that his body was hurt, and you know that hurting does not feel good. So when you take this, don't eat it quite yet. Here you go. And here you go. So when you eat this, this is just to remind you, but when you eat this is supposed to remind you of how much Jesus loves you. And he told us to do this every once in a while, just to remind us that he loved us so much that he would die for us. So here you go. So now when you eat this, remember how much Jesus loves you. It may seem strange at first, but you'll understand it as you get older. So just remember that Jesus loves you. So you can eat your piece of bread or cracker. Okay, so you can just eat that. And right when you're eating it, I'm going to explain what this is. So, you see it kind of... Addison, do you see how it kind of looks like blood? Yeah, it's kind of yucky, but it tastes good, doesn't it? Well, you know, it is wonderful that Jesus died for us. Don't drink it quite yet, but it is wonderful that Jesus died for us. But it's also sad. Is it sad when someone dies? It's sad when someone dies. And just like the grape juice, grape juice, sometimes, have you ever gotten a sour grape? They don't taste really good. Well, it's also really sad and sour of how Jesus had to die for us, but the grape juice also tastes yummy and sweet, right? So when it also tastes sweet, but it also, you can get a sour grape too, so a little bit sour. So that reminds us of how Jesus' death was good, because that means we can go to heaven and live with him and be happy, but also sad because he had to get hurt and go through so much pain to do it for us. So now you can take a drink of that. Just remember how much Jesus loves you, how he loved you so much that he would die for you. Okay. Now I think we're done. So just while the grown-ups, eventually, when you get older, you get to do all with the grown-ups, but for now, you can remind yourself how much Jesus loves you.
The story in the Bible says, reading from Matthew 26 chapter. And as they were eating, Jesus took bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat it. This is my body." Then he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it to them, saying, "Drink it from it, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for many for the remission of sins. But I say to you, I will not drink of this fruit of the vine from now until the day when I drink new with you in my Father's kingdom." It's a beautiful promise. Jesus said, I'm going to deny myself. I am not going to do this until we're going to be in heaven again, everyone. So it's a special thing. Next time Jesus is going to participate in drinking juice like this, he's going to be in heaven. It's going to be the first time since the communion service with his disciples. So we're going to participate in bread and in wine in the morning. Sorry, technical difficulties here. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, this is your body that is going to has been broken for us. Through it we got strengthened. Thank you, dear Lord, that it was not our body but yours. Sacrifice for our salvation. Thank you again, oh Father, for being good and kind. And is going to participate in this. Let us remember this time on the cross when you walked this way. To the Mount of Calvary. Help us to go through this pain, through your suffering, and through your thoughts. Inspire us and touch our minds and hearts. And bless this bread for us, as we ask the Lord Jesus.
Amen.
Took the bread, blessed it, broke it, and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take it, eat it, this is my body." In heaven, let this juice that represents your blood and be a reminder for your sacrifice for us. That is sweet and sour at the same time. Sweet because salvation is obtained, and sour because of great pain and suffering on the cross. So bless us now, and when we participate in this, let us remember of your greatest gift. And here we are.
Here we come to him, who but Jesus Christ.
gave it to them, saying, drink from it, all of you. For this is my blood for the new covenant, which is shed for many for the remission of sin. Although the occasion was solemn and thought-provoking, and many sometimes said, but ended up at least before the Gethsemane with happy note. That's right. Because Matthew says, after the communion service, what did they do? And when they had sung a hymn, they went up to the Mount of Olives. So they sang a song, which we're going to do now ourselves. It will be 329, 21.